So perhaps start with you, Sue. What did you make of the film?
And it says on this thing, the DVD, you will cheer. I didn't cheer. But I was greatly cheered by hearing you all laughing, because you laughed at this, to me, appalling, putting in these scenes of violence and aggression and people being shot and murdered and horrible things alongside this argument as though it's the same kind of thing. So, thank goodness, I think this film will not go down in the same way here as it has amongst far-right religious Christians in America. Our country is very different, and that film is a very American film. But underlying this are some important issues. And I think the one most important thing to me is the way this film completely distorted the nature of biology and the nature of science. And indeed, your introduction rather does that as well, as though there is a debate between the great establishment and, ooh, these brave souls who are prepared to talk about intelligent design. It's not like that, much as it may have looked that way in the film. Biology is a vast and vibrant and creative and wonderful science in which scientists, all of them, are vying to get their theory, you know, better than other people's. And what you do as a scientist, and hey, I've been on the outside, I mean, I'm one of those ones who's always getting bruised for being, you know, having the unconventional ideas. I spent 20 years searching after paranormal phenomena and never finding them. Then I wrote a book about memes, which most scientists think are rubbish, so, you know. So I know what it's like to be on. And what you do is you take an outrageous idea that you think is right and everyone else thinks wrong, and you try and make sense of it, and you look for evidence, and most of the time when people do that, they are wrong, frankly, because most fringe ideas are wrong. But sometimes they're right. And what happens? Those people turn from being on the fringe and rejected to being, wow, lauded and getting all the prizes and being welcomed, because against all the odds, they were right. Now, that process is going on all the time in science. Now, we heard this word Darwinists. It kind of implies that we all believe some coherent thing called Darwinism. But, you know, Darwin was writing 150 years ago. Most of his ideas have been shown to be, well, wrong in the sense that we just know so much more than he could have done. But at the heart of everything that lying there, at the heart of biology, was the most wonderful idea. And I just want to explain this idea before I stop, because this is what really matters. Up until Darwin came along, it was perfectly acceptable. No one could think any other way than to think, if you have design, there must be a designer. Somebody designed this bottle. Somebody designed this glass and this microphone. That's how it is. Young children, as they grow up, spontaneously develop ideas like that. It's the natural way to think. Most cultures think that way. The amazing thing is when you realize what Darwin realized. Now, I know you all know what it is, but I never get sick of it, so I will just go through it again. What he said was, you take some animal, any animal, or plant, or anything, and make some copies. This rabbit will do, or this little lamb, let's have the rabbit. Make 1,000 copies of this rabbit, has lots of babies. Now, there isn't enough food to go round. Some predators come along, yum, 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 and eats most of them up. Some of them don't find mates. Of all the 100 that are produced, only one or two get copied again. So those one or two who get copied, they've got whatever it took to survive. Slightly longer legs, slightly better ears, slightly more cute eyes, whatever it was. And then it happens again. And all of these new copies of the new one have slightly better eyes. But then most of them are killed off because the world isn't big enough for them all to live and there are predators eating them. And then it goes on, and then it goes on. And gradually, by the natural processes of weaning away the less successful ones.
We'll have questions and answers later on. Thank you.
I'm not trying to prove anything.
Well, I'm trying to say
that was his brilliant idea. That underlies it all. And almost every scientist will say yes. They'll argue about how it fits in with epigenetics, how important it is compared with other processes, just, you know, how it works. It's so amazing. But that's why people say Darwin was a genius, and he was. Well, and let's see whether intelligent design can get in there and provide some evidence. And that film didn't provide one spot of evidence.
Okay. Thank you, Susan. Alastair.
Well, I think I couldn't disagree more with what Susan has just said about the film. I'd like to congratulate Premier Radio for bringing it to the United Kingdom, and my hope is that every student in our country will see it. I have found it. I have found it to be the most interesting, the most thought-provoking, in many ways the funniest film I have seen in a long time, but also a film with a deeply serious message. I think this is a great film, and I think the Empire should be allowed to strike back at least once after the tsunami of Darwinism that we've had in 2009. So, Promote the film and let people make up their own mind once they see it. I think the film has three things to say to me, and I've seen it some 10 times or so, and I never tire of seeing it. First of all, it underlines the critical importance of open scientific inquiry. And I think the parallel with Soviet Russia and East Germany is entirely appropriate. The suppression of ideas demeans humankind. So that's a film about freedom of ideas and freedom to express ideas. Secondly, it is a film about science and the way in which science has been now prescribed to be only allowing materialist explanations. In the area of origins, and I emphasise that, in the area of origins, you cannot limit yourself only to material and physical explanations. You must consider intelligent causation. And that's what lies at the heart of intelligent design, and that is what is ruled out by an arbitrary definition of science. Thirdly, the film does actually underline the nature of intelligent design. And I'm appalled that scientists continually get this wrong. Paul Nelson in the film said it as clearly as anyone. Intelligent design is a minimal commitment to the possibility of intelligent causation. That's what it is. And the evidence that Susan doesn't see is the vast bank of genetic information carried in DNA. This is a scientific matter that needs to be explored, and it is a scandal that we are not allowed to look at it and speak about it clearly.
Thank you very much, Alastair. Keith Fox, would you like to give us your reaction to the film?
I'll be quite frank. I found the film to be very sad. I found it to be a mischievous misrepresentation full of half-truths about some of the things that a few scientists believe or don't believe. Let me give you a few examples of this. It portrays intelligent design as if it is science. It is not. Science is to do with material explanations. That is not to do with any religious or anti-religious view at all. That is what science is about investigating the world, giving material explanations that not only explain, but predict and do so reproducibly. Intelligent design may or may not be a theory, but it is not science. Secondly, the film muddles up ideas of freedom of speech. Freedom of speech is a wonderful thing. We all agree with it. But to what degree? Freedom of speech about Holocaust denial, maybe. Freedom of speech to teach astrology in schools, certainly not. Freedom of speech brings with it responsibility to teach truth and not to treat speculation. Thirdly, and I find this probably the most offensive part of the film, is it muddles up belief in God with evolutionary theory. Many of the people that I meet with and I work with are thorough theists from an evangelical Christian perspective who see no problem with evolution at all. The film mischievously picked on some extreme atheists who used their worldview, as John Lennox correctly said, and John Polkinghorne as well, used their worldview on top of their science. They do not derive their worldview from science. There is no problem with being an evolutionist and being a thorough Bible-believing Christian. And I find that offensive, the way that says in the film. I also think the portrayal of saying that evolution necessarily leads to an immoral eugenic society. Clearly, evolution was misappropriated, but there are plenty of ideologies that have been misappropriated over time. To my shame, I say the Christian faith has misappropriated slavery, it's misappropriated apartheid, it has misappropriated the Crusades. But that is not to say that the Christian faith is wrong because of it. Just because a few nation states have used evolution inappropriately does not say anything at all as to whether evolution is right or it is wrong. So I find the film to be full of half-truths and it's rather mischievous. I don't think it's right for the English market.
Thank you very much. Finally, Steve Fuller. Steve is Professor of Sociology at Warwick University. What do you make of the film, Steve, as someone who actually did?
And it wasn't the only film of this kind I've been in. I've also been in one that was, as it were, presented the case against intelligent design that was produced in the United States shortly after the trial in Pennsylvania that I participated in. so I know all about editing and so forth that can happen on both sides. The first thing I would say about the film, since a lot of the people on this panel are complaining about the character of the film, which of course has come up in a lot of the reviews, it seems to me this film, in terms of its style of presentation and its use of montage and so forth, is really no different from what Michael Moore normally does, or in this country, somebody like Adam Curtis even, who you may know from The Power of Nightmares, which was on BBC. And these are these other two filmmakers that I'm talking about, of course, people normally associated with the left and from a rather different ideological perspective. But and they get praised. You know, they're controversial too, but they generally get praised. So I don't think the style of the filmmaking is particularly problematic. At least we're used to it in other ideological contexts. And that would be the first thing I would say. And frankly, the more I see the film, actually, the more sensible it looks to me, to be perfectly honest. I think there's a sense in which the first showing may be quite sensationalistic, but I think if you look at it again and you think about what's actually being said, I think it is indeed, as Alastair says, a very good kind of pedagogical tool, and I have in fact used it in classrooms. The issue about whether this business about intelligent design, whether it's a controversial issue in this country, well, you know, let's think about last year only in the case of Michael Rice, who was the director of communications for the Royal Society, who at the meeting of the British Association for the Advancement of Science basically said that if a student were to bring up issues relating to creationism or intelligent design in the biology class, that the teacher, even if they disagree with the student, nevertheless should entertain those questions. Okay, that was enough to be seen as opening the door to some kind of creationism and intelligent design. And he basically was kind of, he wasn't exactly fired, but it was certainly kind of hounded out in a way. And this is a person who is an ordained minister, but also one of the leading researchers in science education in this country, who's a professor at the Institute of Education. So he's not just a public relations guy. Okay? And so, in a sense, we're beginning, you know, as this issue actually gets publicly discussed in this country, it doesn't take very long before the kind of expelled phenomena starts to get registered. It's just it hasn't really come up yet. But as soon as the issue does get raised, similar sorts of reactions are beginning to take place. I mean, I think one reason why, in a sense, it's a real powder keg issue in the United States has a lot to do with the formal separation of church and state. And insofar as intelligent design is portrayed as religiously motivated, which is, of course, is an open question that people can discuss here, right, that's problematic from a legal standpoint in the United States. It is not a problem from a legal standpoint in this country, okay? So, in a sense, that legal backdrop that causes all the controversy does not exist here. So, in a sense, this issue should be able to be discussed much more openly.
Well, that's what we're aiming to do
in
today's debates. Maybe we could start by talking about what is at the center of the film, which is this idea that there's a consensus view in science which cannot be challenged.
Well, it's ridiculous.
Why do you say that's ridiculous?
There's a consensus in the sense that some theories have so much evidence for them that nearly everybody agrees with them. But then what happens is after a few years or a few decades, that consensus will start to shift because some kind of evidence, we talk about paradigm shifts, some kind of evidence will start building up. Now, we're human, we scientists are human, so we learn all this stuff, we learn our theories, and we have a certain resistance to having to give them up and have a new one. So of course there's a kind of resistance, but if the evidence gets big enough, then everybody shifts and the consensus goes somewhere else. In the case of biology, there are certain things that just kind of stay there fundamentally, and same in physics. In physics, you know, Newton's laws, within the range that they are now known to apply, will just stay there. Of course there's a consensus. But and then, you know, you go off into Einstein and everything
else. The film talks about there being a wall, though.
Absolute
not just a consensus,
rubbish.
There's a wall
Absolute rubbish.
Scientists who are questioning the Darwinian paradigm are being excluded, expelled, etc.
I think that's complete rubbish. Let me give you an analogy. I mean, I've already mentioned, I started out my life believing in the paranormal because I had this amazing out-of-the-body experience and mystical experiences, which I've had often in my life. And I thought this meant that my spirit had left my body. And I was absolutely determined to prove to all those closed-minded scientists that they were wrong and so on and so on. So I set out to do the research. And it was extremely painful because after some years, I discovered I was wrong. And the evidence actually came out. We now understand how out-of-body experiences take place in the brain. We know where, you know, it's taken decades to find out, but we do now understand them pretty well. But in that beginning, I was, if you like, the other side of the wall. What did I do? I funded my own PhD. I got in there. I did the research. Nobody tried to stop me. They just said, oh, we think you think you're batty. Now, I could have been right. and then I would have overcome it. That's how it happens. That's a reality in science. If you come up with an idea that most people think is rubbish, you've got to take the flak.
So, people do. From your point of view, then, it's just that intelligent design hasn't shown it's got the
absolutely
credentials.
If it did, hey, wouldn't that be exciting? Okay, well, I mean, it would really be exciting.
What do you make of that, Alastair?
Well, there is a central issue that I think we need to face. And it is that of recent times, and the film dealt with this, we have discovered in the living cell a vast store of genetic information. Now, a self-respecting scientist is going to ask the question, where does that information come from? Now, when you look back to the origin of that information, you've got to ask yourself, what sort of sources give rise to information? And the only known source of functional, specified information is intelligent mind. Now, when Keith says we cannot allow an explanation other than a material explanation, he's like a man saying we are only allowed to explain traffic lights in black and white. You must consider the possibility that that information is a reflection of intelligent mind.
Please don't misunderstand
me. Please let me finish. And the intelligent design theory is about the origin of that information. And what intelligent design theorists are asking is that in that area of scientific inquiry, we must open our minds to the possibility of intelligent causation. I would have thought that was the most sensible way to explain the origin of information.
I am not suggesting that science is the answer to every question that mankind raises. There are plenty of questions that are not related to science at all. But science has its own methodologies. It's concerned with mechanisms. We may say there's an intelligent creator. Supposing there is, what mechanism does that imply? Where does that take us in terms of saying that the intelligent creator has put something there? That's a science stopper. What are we going to do in terms of explaining that at the bench, in the laboratory?
May I respond to that?
Yes, please do.
Here you are, a biologist, looking at a vast information store and saying you are unable to make any conclusions about where it came from. You're looking at traffic lights in black and white. And if science can't deal with that, so much the worse for science.
But you're also
Science must therefore stop making pronouncements about origins if it can't deal with that area.
You're also
I think your definition of mind. Your definition of science, I think, is inadequate.
One very quick response to that is I think, again, we're muddling the origin of life with evolution. Evolution is concerned how organisms and species develop over time.
I'm not talking
evolution itself does not talk about the origin of life and evolution and the genetic code itself. That is something that Richard Dawkins was quite right in saying, that scientists really haven't got a clue.
Are you saying that the idea of it being intelligently caused, the origin of life, is out of bounds?
I don't think it's not out of bounds. It just doesn't get us anywhere.
Yeah.
What do you make of that, Steve?
Well, it seems to me that the difference between where the debate really takes place between Darwinism and intelligent design isn't quite at the level at which, especially the way Susan was talking about it. Yes, there is consensus within particular disciplines of science, so let's say molecular biology, genetics, and so forth. But the difference between intelligent design, and this comes out with the origins question, is how do you put the evidence provided by the different disciplines together to come up with some sort of overarching story of what the nature of life is? And there it seems to me there's a lot of disagreement, right? So even if there's a lot of consensus within particular scientific disciplines, how you weigh the various bits of evidence that these disciplines provide is an open question. And this is, in fact, why the theological questions always kind of get in there, right? Because there's a sense in which we're asking kind of ultimate levels of explanation questions, and it's very hard to escape from the origins questions under those circumstances.
I think a lot of people do have this association of intelligent design with biblical creationism. Now, what the film was trying to obviously do was make a distinction there and saying you don't have to be a Christian, you can be an agnostic, a Jew, or whatever, to believe in intelligent design. What do you make of that? Do you believe it is inevitably associated with sort of Christian?
Do you mind if I just pick up Alistair's business about where the
just
information
quickly, and
comes
then
from?
We'll move on.
This is what I was trying to say, and I'm sure many of you will have seen that. Where the information comes from is this amazing process of natural selection. You start with something quite simple, but if you make lots of copies that are slightly different, and most of them can't survive, you get complexity out of nowhere.
The origin of life,
that's can't you see it? Can't you see how it works? It's amazing.
I have to say to you, that's nonsense.
It's not nonsense.
Natural selection can only operate on something that's there. The question that intelligent design is addressing is, how did the information get there in the first place?
That's not evolution.
Until it is there, and Keith, while you're shaking your head, ID is not the opposite of evolution. We need to be clear about this. ID is not the opposite of evolution. ID is probably the opposite of materialism. There are plenty of ID theorists who embrace large stretches of evolutionary theory. We're making a category error if we say that intelligent design is the opposite of Darwinism, because Darwinism could be the design. I don't happen to think it is in significant degree, but they are not opposites. Intelligent design is about the freedom to explore intelligent causation for specific information in biological systems. Now, that's not hard to grasp, and that's where the argument is.
I don't entirely disagree with that statement.
Well, I'm very pleased to hear it. But, very pleased to hear it.
But going back to Justin's original question, is that the film portrayed evolution as being hard to grasp hold of, something that's very slippery. It's extremely easy to grasp hold of compared with intelligent design, which is exceptionally slippery and has a spectrum that goes right through from young Earth creationists who believe that the world is no more than 6,000 years old to those who say that actually evolution itself was the way the designer worked. That's a tremendous different spectrum. In some cases, it's a cloak for young Earth creationism. In some instances, it's almost no different from what I believe is the face of evolution.
You're listening to me. It's not that. Intelligent design
I was asking Justin's
is a minimal commitment to the possibility of intelligent causation. That's what it is.
But people do accuse it of being creationism dressed up in a cheap tuxedo. That's one phrase I've heard recently. Why... obviously, it has this reputation, and indeed, you were involved in the trial that you mentioned in America where intelligent design was thrown out of court. The judge ruled that it was essentially a religious viewpoint. Intelligent design was not science, it was a religious viewpoint. What would you make of that particular viewpoint, Steve?
Well, I mean, the way it came about in the trial, it's basically because of who the defendants were, right? It is true that in the actual trial, you basically had a creationist school board that was, in a way, looking for trying to get creationist views into the classroom. So the motivation of those particular people certainly fits the stereotype, okay? And that was one reason why the Discovery Institute basically pulled out any kind of support from this trial. The Discovery Institute, which is the sort of mecca of intelligent design theory, refused to get involved in the trial.
But from your point of view, that skewed the issue, did it then?
Yes, because the judge basically made a kind of blanket judgment in the end, basically saying that the fact that the school board, which was creationist motivated, turned to intelligent design shows the entire theory is suspect. I mean, that was basically how the argument went. There were very few people testifying on the intelligent design side because the Discovery Institute refused to cooperate.
Let's just turn to the question of ethics, because that's certainly the way the film ends up. In many ways, this link that is drawn between Nazi eugenics and Darwinism. You've already intimated that you felt that was a wrong association to draw. But we've heard Steve on the film himself saying that there is a sense in which he talked about a deprivileging of human life when we see it in these purely materialistic terms that many evolutionists want to put it in.
Here are some really important issues. And of course, I'll go about them like a scientist does, because that's my kind of way of thinking. And I want to say, right, at the heart of this, then, it's kind of testable. Because let's have a look at, for example, different cultures, more religious and less religious cultures, and see how people behave. Because honestly, if religious people behave better than non-religious people, that's important. And we now, in the recent few years, have some very good evidence. For example, a sociologist called Gregory Paul has done a lot of the research, but there are other people doing it as well. In 2005, he did a big study comparing developed nations, in which he found that the more religious was a given nation, the higher the rates of murder, suicide, teenage pregnancy, gonorrhea and syphilis infections, and marital breakdown. He's subsequently gone on to do many more studies of this kind. Some of his methodology has been challenged, quite rightly so, because he didn't do it very well in the first place. He's now gone and done it better. There seem to be very high correlations between a nation being religious and all kinds of societies breakdown. Now, You might think I'm saying religion causes these things, but subsequently a lot of other researchers have gone in and found it doesn't look that way at all. What it actually appears to be is that as a society becomes fairer, are more equal in terms of income inequality, has better health care, you know, like universal health care like we have here, has a more socialist or welfare state system, then people feel safe, they feel less frightened, and they don't need religion so much. And the United States, which is an outlier in all of this because it has such high levels of murder and doesn't have health care for all, and all of these things which lead to higher levels of fear, they end up more religious. Now, there's a long way to go in this, but these are questions that we can answer, and I think must answer because they're important.
Given that this was an area you specifically addressed in the film.
Yeah, I think you've changed the topic slightly. I mean, the issue is whether there's anything distinctive about human beings. So, in other words, should we be worrying about these crime figures in the first place?
Yeah.
Okay? And it seems to me that when we talk about specifically a Darwinian perspective, and here I want to go back to this business about whether we're talking about evolution in blanket sense. I think the specific thing about Darwinism, as opposed to other forms of evolution, is that it's a sort of species egalitarian view at the end of the day. Darwinism, right? So in other words, there's no sense in which human beings are superior, you know, intellectually or ethically or anything like that, right? I mean, we're either adapted or not adapted to our environments, and as it were, time will tell. And so the issue then becomes, where do issues like the sanctity of human life, where do they belong in this story? Why should we be worried about whether human beings are being killed or not? You know, at the end of the day, it might actually control the population. It might be a very cheap way of doing it. Right? I mean, there's a sense in which if you're a Darwinist, those kinds of questions start to become very alive for you, right? To what extent do you want to actually engage in this kind of normative enforcement? You know, it might cost too many resources. And also, when you do your welfare functions for your welfare state, does it just cover human beings or does it cover animals as well? In which case, we might have to cut the human beings off at the margins to allow some of the more productive animals to live, right? Enter Peter Singer. No, seriously. And this is the kind of thing that gets opened up. Right? Darwinism doesn't necessitate you go down this route, but it certainly does open up that kind of normative horizon in a way that other sorts of viewpoints that actually privilege human beings, you know, so for example, this intelligent design certainly does that in terms of our archetype of intelligent design is what human intelligence is, right? So there's already a privileging going on there. And I think one way you see how we've already gone down this route is you do have evolutionary psychologists like Steven Pinker trashing the concept of dignity. Right, of human dignity, that this is a kind of, you know, from a Darwinian standpoint, the notion of dignity is a kind of outmoded notion. Because this was a notion that came up very much in Bush's bioethics panel, right, with Leon Cass and people like that. And you know, Pinker's point was, this presumes some sort of essentialist notion of species and some kind of notion of human beings as being superior that just cannot be grounded biologically, that we have to really think in different sorts of normative terms, and that dignity doesn't really capture it. Well, then what does?
Well, I'd be interested in hearing from Keith here, because obviously you fully accept the theory of evolution, Keith, but you...
Which theory of evolution? There are loads of them.
Oh, now we do. So now there are loads of them. As many as intelligent design or a few?
I want to move on to question and answer, but so briefly, Keith, what's your response to this idea that there is a link between Darwinism and deprivileging of human life?
I think we've strayed off the subject of evolution, rather, within this, actually. This is a question about morality and ethics and what it means to be human, not necessarily about evolution. It does touch on what some people, how they apply evolution. As a Christian, as a theist, I would go with the words of Dostoevsky, who said, without God, all things are permissible. And that's not to say that only Christians behave well. They certainly don't sometimes. And it's not to say that atheists can't behave well. Clearly they do. But it is a question of motivation. It's not anything to do with evolution or intelligent design. It's to do with materialism / scientism, or a worldview that encompasses other things as well. And that's why I think we've strayed off of the debate as we get on to this.
Certainly, I do want to bring us back, ultimately, to what I think is the core of the film, which is this issue of whether there is freedom of thought in science. And we've discussed that to some extent. So I think we'll open the floor to questions now. We've got two people with roving microphones. Yes, the gentleman in red. Could you stand up and give us your name and ask your question or comment?
Hello. My name's Jeffrey Ford. I'd like to ask both Keith and Sue why they conflate natural selection within a species with this thing of evolution and how one species can become another. Additionally, my issue with Darwin is not so much a theistic position. His views extended in his later book, The Ascent of Man, were taken up by the slave trade to justify the fact that the black man was a less developed creature than the white man. And that's my issue, and I'd be interested in your comments on that.
Thank you. Darwin was a man of his time, and we are not making a saint out of Darwin. In fact, I don't use the word Darwinism. It's evolution. We talk about neo-Darwinism. It's the theory that has progressed beyond that. In terms of his treatment of black people, there's no way that we could accept that. But he was a man of the Victorian times. In terms of your question about species, species actually are human construct. There's nothing that takes a tag that says this is a species. As biologists who like to put things into categories, we define things as species. And there's evolution within species, and there's evolution between species. But to a large extent, that's just the way that we like to put things in boxes.
Yes, species are a human concept, and there's no rigid boundaries and so on. But the real question that relates to, did God put the species fully formed on the planet, or did they evolve from predecessors? Well, in the case of humans, for example, we know the common ancestor of us and the ape and the chimpanzees came after the common ancestor with us and the gorillas. I mean, we know these things from skeletons, from analysis of DNA mutation rates. We know them from masses and masses of different kinds of science. That's how it is.
Yes, I'd like to make one point, and it would be really good to try and be clear about this. The point of departure between intelligent design and neo-Darwinism is that the mechanism for generating biological, genetic information. The Darwinian story depends on random mutation and natural selection. Mm-hmm. Intelligent design says that is an inadequate explanation, and we have to consider the possibility that our universe and living things are front-loaded with information that drive the process. It's not about the range of Darwinism, it's about the mechanism of generating genetic complexity. And if we could focus on that, I think we would see where the difference of view is.
And if you provided evidence for that, it would be brilliant and amazing. And if you could provide evidence for that, it would be fantastic.
Susan, I've tried to provide it to you.
No, you've made an argument.
No, hang on. It is a scientific inference. Where you have in DNA a vast store of specified information, the only known source in all the world of specified information is intelligent mind. Why would that not be the case in the
essentially, DNA? What it sounds like you're saying is that Susan has an assumption, a presupposition, if you like, that there, because there is no God, there cannot be an intelligent cause in this instance, even though in the rest of the
science... Yes, well, maybe, but I'm not talking about God. I'm talking about a scientist looking at the information and saying, how do we get this? Random mutation, natural selection?
Is enough.
I don't think so. A better explanation is that there is evidence here of intelligent mind.
At the risk of being tedious, can I ask how the intelligent designer put the information there? And I'm not denying the intelligent designer. I believe in a God and the Christian God. But how did that intelligent designer put it there? Was it by irrational means or by rational scientific means? And to me, that it was put there by rational scientific means, not disobeying the laws of nature, not in a way in which some divine engineer had to come in and tinker with a system that he messed up in the first instance.
That's not the issue. You're dodging the issue.
Just move on to the next question at this point. I'm telling you, move on.
We could go around this for a long time. Yeah. Let's bring someone in the centre here, the young man with the blue T-shirt. If you want to stand up, give us your name and ask your question or comment.
Hi, my name's Martin. I have a question for Alastair, is it, in the jacket? You spoke about, in your initial statements, about you want to know where this information in DNA is coming from, and you also spoke about a sort of a need for openness, a discussion of this in the scientific community. And yet, you stated quite strong support for the message that this film Expelled has been giving out. And I think you were given at least a suggestion in that film from Michael Ruse, where his information came from, that about it arising on crystals. Now, that was presented as very much a kind of crystal ball, yuck, yuck, yuck. Whereas anyone with a basic knowledge of chemistry knows that surface catalysis, I'm sorry, I phrased that badly, I didn't mean to say that you don't, but anyone with the knowledge of circus catalysis knows that it's at least a reasonable suggestion. Why are you endorsing a film that has this attitude to a suggestion that doesn't involve a designer? I realize that there is a grievance. There's a grievance from people who feel that intelligent design isn't being taken seriously, but that just seems to be like hypocrisy from the other direction.
Okay, well, let me talk about the issue you've raised rather than talk about the film. There are two problems about biological molecules. One is getting the chemical sequences correct, and then the second is encoding them with digital information. Now, of all the explanations I've ever heard, Michael Ruse is about the poorest. And what I'm suggesting to you is that we are looking at a vast level of chemical complexity, and then encoded in that is genetic information. The best analogy is a PC. You encode on chemistry digitally coded information. That's what's happened in nature, and I think that is the challenge to explain. And certainly natural selection is not going to do it.
Can I add something?
Yes, please do, Steve.
You know, as someone who's not a specialist in this particular area, I think you're watching the film a little too uncharitably. I actually think what it's trying to do is to stress the speculative nature of the explanations that have been offered at the moment. And I think the same would also apply to the comments that Richard Dawkins makes toward the end of the film as well. Namely, and in a sense, there's everything to play for, you might say, when it comes to the most important issues regarding the origin of life, and that contrary to what the film presents is a lot of the hype coming from the Darwinist side, things are not all sewed up yet. That in a sense, when it comes to ultimate explanations, things are still very speculative. And one of the ways in which you can kind of draw attention to that is by, you know, portraying these things in a slightly comical light, it seems to me. I don't think that's such a bad thing to do.
It does boil down again to this question, though, of is as the film claims, intelligent design being ruled out simply because
it's not being ruled out.
To the assumption of God?
No, but it's not being ruled out. It's just being treated like every idea that hasn't yet proved
This is false from a strictly empirical standpoint. One thing that did actually come up in the trial in Pennsylvania when Michael Behe was being cross-examined was the fact that if you actually claim that this, you know, kind of what happened to Steve Meyer, if you actually, you know, make an argument and then you say this provides some kind of support for intelligent design, right, you can't get the thing published but also you could explain it through evolution and that's the preferred way of doing it. So in other words, even if that was what led you to draw the conclusion you did, you're not allowed to put it in the paper.
That would be bad if it were so.
It is so.
It is so. Absolutely so.
It is so. And that's why you don't see it in the journals. It's censored out.
I can see someone who's foaming at the mouth at the front here.
Don't presume.
Ed Turner, I know your name already. So
hello, my name's Ed.
I think we're on, yeah.
My blog is Manic Street Preacher. I just wanted to haul the film up, really, on its disgraceful portrayal of Darwin as inspiring eugenics. The quote that Ben Stein reads out from Descent of Man is actually a common quote mine. If you'd read the very next passage, it would have shown that Darwin was actually opposed to such appalling practices. He was an abolitionist of slavery. He was about as racist as anyone was in his time, but he supported abolition. I've taken up David Belinsky and read the English translation of Mein Kampf. It does not contain a reference to Darwin or Nietzsche at all, but Hitler talks about his belief in heaven, God, the Almighty, rather a lot.
Yes.
Selection. The word selection is very strong in Mein Kampf.
Okay, so you feel the film overplays this kind of idea that... do you want to respond to that, Alastair?
Well, I would suggest reading Richard Weikart's work on the connection between Nazi ideology and Darwinism. I think David Berlinsky put a number of qualifications in there. If you were going to try and persuade me that Hitler was not influenced by Darwin, that Stalin was not influenced by Darwin, I'd find it difficult to believe you.
But it's still irrelevant. It's still irrelevant. Yeah. The question is the neo-Darwinian synthesis, is it correct or not? Not have people misapplied it.
Well,
that's the question of intelligent design.
I accept that, but I think it did have an influence on Adolf Hitler.
Okay. I think there's an issue about how many scientists... it's a little frustrating to hear, well, these people misappropriate Darwin. What if it's most of the genetics community of the time? Okay, in the most scientifically advanced country in the world. and they're advocating this before Hitler gets around. I mean, so in other words, you know, these ideas do suggest these kinds of things even without Hitler being around. And in fact, there's another book, I mean, because Weikart, you know, in a way has his cards on the table, but someone who doesn't even come from an intelligent design perspective, there's a book called The Pure Society that was published by Verso, a left-wing publisher, earlier this year, or last year, which basically shows how just about everybody in the early history of genetics supported eugenics of some sort, And this is long before Hitler, okay? And so there is a, you know, you, beyond a certain point, you just cannot use the misappropriation argument. It's just part of what the science naturally leads to.
But I'm probably the last person in this world to quote from Richard Dawkins. I do not admire the man's theology at all. In terms of the God delusion, he doesn't understand theology or philosophy. But let me read you something that he wrote in The Selfish Gene towards the end of that. He says, we have the power to defy the selfish genes of our birth. We could even discuss ways of deliberately cultivating and nurturing pure, disinterested altruism. We alone on earth can rebel against the tyranny of the selfish replicators. It doesn't inevitably lead...
Sure, if you suspend Darwinism at that point, he can say what he wants.
Yeah,
I guess that's what people on your side do. The theistic evolutionist. At some point you stop Darwin and you start talking theology.
The person in the red... jumper at the back.
Hello,
give us
my name's
your
Jeremiah.
Your question.
Yeah, my question is for Sue. I felt that you were somewhat biased against the film, and you didn't take into consideration that in America there definitely is a consensus amongst the scientific elite to suppress intelligent design as a theory. So maybe in this country we might not be as repressive. I don't know. But in America they definitely have an issue there. So I'm curious as to why you didn't take into consideration that there were many scientists who have been struck off or who have been expelled from their profession because they believe in intelligent design.
There are huge differences between here and the States, and although I have been there quite a lot and been to many conferences and I know quite a few scientists, I've never worked within that system. The whole idea of tenure, where you have to get tenure and until then you can't really feel free to speak, applies in all sorts of areas of science. Because I've already mentioned the fact that I've always worked on the fringes and I've kind of got used to that, and I think I accept that. That's how it's bound to be. It's much more difficult if the ideas you're putting forward are new, fringy, don't have lots of other people supporting them. It's always going to be difficult. Now, I do think it's better here. We don't have this tenure system. We have a long tradition of science going back very much further. I think it is easier for British scientists. But as for the truth of those particular cases in that film, you know, if I were to do my homework, I would have to spend weeks going and tracking all those down. I do know some people who've tried, Michael Shermer and others, and who say that it's wildly exaggerated in that film. But I personally don't have an intimate knowledge of that, so I'd rather not state a strong position. I'll admit some biases and I won't admit others. I will admit that I don't know just how much truth there is in those. I can certainly look at what's happened in my lifetime, my knowledge of science, and think that just doesn't stack up, and I don't, you know, I think it's exaggerated. But my dislike of the film, which I watched the night before last and again today, was largely this intercutting of all these horrible things, the implications done by the imagery. Now, you say maybe that's common in American cinema or whatever.
Michael Moore, it happens all the time.
Okay, yeah, but that's not so, you know, I don't...
Michael Moore is a big deal here, too.
Okay, maybe, but I'm just saying there were lots of things about it I didn't like. There were lots of things that I thought were untrue, but I've expressed in my little two-minute speech my main problem, which is it sets up two sides where there aren't. There are hundreds and hundreds of sides and lots of differences. Okay. But well, I do think free speech lives in science
we'll
in Britain,
to
yes.
Another questioner. The young lady, yes, waving your hand. If you could. Your name, please.
Hi, my name is Dorcas. This is to Sue. You keep saying, when Alistair comments on, you know, looking at the information in the genetic pool, you know, there's so much information and everything that we know, and I'm not really a scientist, but I believe that you study something and the more it occurs, you come to a conclusion that this is a law. It's, we have the first and second law of thermodynamics. If we look at information and we see that every time there is a massive information, an intelligent mind put it there. I mean, we do it all the time, computers, TVs, even that bottle over there, somebody designed it because, do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Right, and from that we conclude that if there is so much information in one cell, there must have been an intelligent designer. Yeah. To me, that is evidence.
Okay.
It's evidence because everything that we see tells us that whenever there is information, an intelligent mind put it there. Now, if you think that, where is your evidence, Alistair? My question to you is, where is your evidence that there can be something so complex as a cell that doesn't require an intelligent mind?
Thank you.
It's a really nice question. Yes, you're right to clap, because it's the heart of the question, really. And this is what I was trying to say about the fact that is the natural way we think, because that's what we see around us. Those are the natural analogies that we draw. It took a brilliant mind like Darwin's, or Wallace's and other people around at the time, to see there's another way. There's another way that information can come out, that design can appear in the world. So if you... Now, I'm not saying... Now, hang on. Please let be fair to this. Now, I'm saying there's another way. Then we have to find the evidence on either side and see which is doing it. It could be both. It could be only one. It could be neither. But there is another way, and that's natural selection. Now, where did all this information come from? We just don't know the very beginning. But if you take a little bit of information, a little tiny bit of genetic information, such as was around in the very, very early prokaryotes, the simplest kinds of cells, or even before that when there were naked replicators, which we know about from all kinds of different chemical and biochemical evidence. Take those. Now, you can get a little bit of genetic information. It just accidentally gets copied twice and stuck together, so you've got more. Now apply natural selection to that, and some bits get chosen and passed on and some don't. Accidentally, it develops again and you get multiple copies. That's the way information appears, and natural selection hones
it to
make design.
We're back again to the issue of the origin of life.
Now, hang on. Let me just make one important point. I'm not saying that I absolutely know that's how it is and there couldn't be intelligent design. I'm saying biology has done amazingly well on that model. Yes, by all means, let people come up with the idea that some intelligence put it there. Let's let the theories fight it out according to the evidence.
And that's
what they should be doing.
But isn't that the point of the film, that they're not being allowed to?
Yeah, I know, but I think...
To do that, isn't that what the film is saying? Is there a level playing field?
I think, but freedom of speech lives on in this country.
Of course it does. And the film is setting it up as though there's this big monolith and this little thing fighting it. The truth is there's masses of complications and all sorts of people fighting, and it can be in there fighting. Great, you know, if someone comes up with the evidence.
I would invite Keith and Susan to read the Department of Education and Science's guidance of a few years ago about how intelligent design was to be handled within science. And the position is nothing like you describe it. It is not to be regarded as science, and that's the problem. We do not have freedom of inquiry about this matter in science.
But that was my point at the beginning. Yes. There's a difference between freedom of speech and inquiry in the research labs, in the university, in the academy, and freedom of teaching in schools, where we're teaching at a basic level, fundamental, accepted science. There's a very great difference in that.
Keith, we are allowing our school children to be taught that life emerged from inanimate matter without intelligent mind and without design. Now, that may be one hypothesis, but it is nothing more than speculation, and it's a
much
disgrace.
Much more than speculation.
Can I add to this? One more comment.
I disagree with what you say the school should be. The school should actually try to open up students' minds. So it's especially in that context, because by the time they get to university and they're majoring in scientific subjects, and maybe they pick up something about intelligent design in some course they take in history or philosophy of science, it's too late, right? You really have to get it in the high school.
I take a totally contradictory view to that, that maybe it says a different form of paranoia. Most school children's understanding of evolution, let alone science in general, is pathetic. So when they come to university, having done GCSE and A-level, it's quite the opposite extreme. They cannot justify Darwinian evolution any more than they can say what might or might not be wrong with intelligent design. It says we should have better scientific education.
Okay, with the interesting-looking T-shirt that seems to have a Darwinian reference on it.
My name is Ray Descombs. I found the film fascinating and very frustrating in many ways as a Christian. I felt it was in many ways dishonest and set up a false dichotomy. And that false dichotomy was that belief in evolution must be equated with atheism, and belief in Christianity must be equated with intelligent design or some form of creationism. Now, I believe that what we see in the Christian world, and what we saw from some of the people who were interviewed, John Polkinghorne, Alistair McGrath, these people are Christians, passionately so, and they are convinced that evolution, understood in Darwinian ways, is the way in which the diversity of life we see has come to be. To them, we could add people like Francis Collins, Darrell Falk, Keith Miller, who testify in Dover, and these men are Christians, and it is eminently acceptable and honourable to be a Christian who believes in evolution and recognises it as the means by which the diversity we see has come to be. Isn't that the case? And why does this film dishonestly set up that dichotomy?
Let's allow a response from Steve and Alastair then.
Well, the only point I would make is, if the science of Darwinism at base, at origin, is suspect, why would I build my theology around it?
We're not. People are not building a theology around Darwinism.
It's showing, as
you would expect, if there is a creator who has made this world, the world in which we see it will be consistent with the nature of the creator. So it's actually saying there's a consistency between those two, a coherence. It's not saying that one influence...
Where's the theological license to trust the consensus of the scientific community? This is what I don't get, because I think a lot of the people who hold a position that you hold basically have a kind of segregated view about science and religion. There's a sort of authoritative religious view, you know, maybe a kind of weak liberal Anglican view, and then there is the scientific authority, right? And they sort of coexist as if they were two opposite sides of your hemisphere, of your brain, right? I don't see that as intellectually credible. I mean, I think that's a way of avoiding arguments. It's a nice way to avoid arguments, but I don't see how that's intellectually credible. I mean, I think Richard Dawkins was absolutely right when he said both religion and science are making existence claims, and it seems to me that there are some serious contradictions between Darwinism and Christianity as normally understood. And you just cannot say you trust the scientists. You know, you trust the scientist 6 days a week, and on Sunday you trust the priest. You can't do it that way.
Can I correct Stephen? I am not a liberal Anglican. I happen to be an Anglican. I'm probably at the more conservative evangelical end of things. So I want to make that abundantly clear.
Hey, for me, liberal is not a bad word. Science
as we know it arose within the context, a lot of it arose within the context of a Christian theology. They believed there was law in nature because they understood there was a lawgiver.
And those people typically didn't believe in a scientific consensus. They were the radicals. They were the ones who were, in fact, doing the kind of thing intelligent design theory is doing today, challenging the established authorities, which at that time were controlled by the church.
The suggestion is that you're in some way bound by the science, the consensus in science, and that you've then tailored your theology to suit that. Is that a fair analysis of
like all of us, I'm a complex being, and I'm not simply a scientist on one day.
Irreducibly
on
complex,
Well, I hope I'm intelligently designed. Anyway,
you're great at that.
You definitely are.
You definitely are.
And I can't separate my being as a scientist and my being as a Christian. I'm a whole person. And there's an integrity in that, I hope.
I want to squeeze in a couple more questions. So let's allow a couple more people to... Okay, the gentleman with glasses and a grey T-shirt just here. We could have you...
Hi, my name is Perry Anver. my comment really is just on the last comment instead of comments. As I understand it, I would also take a similar position that you can actually hold. I'd disagree with Steve Fuller here. That you can hold to looking where the scientific evidence is at and also having your theology. Now, the thing is, as a Christian, as an evangelical Christian, I base my theology on terms of what the Bible says. But also, as a scientist, you look at the evidence in the physical world and see what that says. And then you try and marry the two together. Now, those marriages are theology, and theology isn't necessarily the word of God or whatever. It doesn't have the same status as that. Mm-hmm. But in all science, I mean, there are different categories of understanding. So looking at biology, for example, we all believe that we were formed from a fertilized egg, and we can explain that mechanistically in those terms. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't deny necessarily that also I am a person made in the image and likeness of God. And to say that knowing and understanding those mechanisms diminishes that is completely wrong. Genesis 1 and 2 tell us two things about the creation of humanity. It says that we are made from the dust of the ground, and it says that we're made in the image and likeness of God.
Yes.
And as a scientist, I think that the science tells us maybe something about the dustiness of our humanity. And as a Christian, I believe that the Bible tells us what it means to be made in the image and likeness of God.
We've covered this area, so I'm going to let that stand as a comment rather than as a question to the panel. Let's move on and just... I'll have two women to finish off. Would you like to give a comment? Let's have the microphone for the young lady in the red top, and then we'll come to the lady in the blue top.
Please may I ask the panel what they think of the very spurious Christian argument that intelligent design is provable, because if not, therefore a Boeing 747 could have been created by an explosion in a scrap heap. I mean, surely the fact that something is random does not take away the fact that it could happen.
Okay. So the question is, they're sometimes put about this example of a whirlwind in a scrap heap producing a Boeing 747. That's what some Christians say, that's the equivalent of evolution, an undirected process producing something very complex. Is that a fair analysis of what intelligent design is saying?
All analogies have the limitations, and that one certainly has limitations. But let me ask you to reflect on this analogy. Bill Gates has said that the software programs he generates in Microsoft are not nearly as complex as the software in DNA. So I ask you to reflect on this. Does Bill Gates get his software by opening the windows and letting the weather blow through his laboratories?
If you think anyone is saying evolution is a random process, it's not. It has randomness at certain stages. The important thing is natural selection. Not everything can survive. The few things that survive are different from the ones that die. That difference makes all the difference. That's where the design comes from. Of course you wouldn't get a 747 by blowing through. Of course 1,000 monkeys typing on typewriters are not going to type Macbeth. It requires natural selection and many other processes as well, as we discover them as we go along, to produce the amazing design we have in the universe that evolution produces.
And we are going to have to make this the final question, and I did say it would go to this lady in the blue top.
Yes, my name is Joanna Ennis, and I want to come back to the whole point of this film. I saw it as a warning to the Christian community that this war was in existence, and that we ought to be challenging that. I want to challenge Sue Blackmore in that she said, oh, it's not like that in this country. We don't have the same, way of doing things as in America, the cases that were cited in the movie. But I would say that's not true. We need the warning sound in this country, because you've got to watch any natural history program in the last 5 years, and it is always presented on BBC or anywhere else in the media as fact that evolution is fact.
Let's allow Keith, I'll have Keith respond to that first, and we'll get some comments from our other guests, and we'll have to draw things from
unfortunately there. The media like conflict, and there is that historically has not been a conflict between the scientific understanding and a religious understanding in this country. But the media like to generate one, which is why most of the programs you see are taken by people who adopt an extreme position. It doesn't make good media to have reported Christian accepts evolution. It's rather a yawn for the media. They like to see conflict, and it's actually up for sane, rational people to say there isn't a conflict. We live together, there is a debate, we're engaged together, but it is not a matter of limiting freedom of speech in this country.
I'll come to Alastair, then to you, Sue, so we've got some intermixing of comments in this final section.
I'm a Scot, as you've probably detected.
No.
And a great admirer of Alexander Fleming, the discoverer of penicillin. I ask you to reflect on the fact that one man noticed something that nobody else had noticed, and probably all of us owe our life to that discovery. I think the intelligent design theorists have found something in the information content of biology that has been overlooked, and I think it will transform this argument.
Sue.
Referring to that last lady's question, I took you to be saying we've got all these wonderful science programs on television which take various forms of evolution for granted. Well, quite rightly they do. When you have David Attenborough giving a wonderful explanation of why the whale is behaving the way it is, or why the deer is being caught by the tiger, because it's been observed, because we have the evidence, and he's he's telling it like it is. Great. I'm glad we have that. And so
finally, Steve Fuller.
Actually, I'll disagree with this. I actually think it would be useful in these science programs to present more debate and more discussion and not just good pictures.
Some do. Well, yes, but some do. Those are the nice, softy-feely picture ones.
You know, I mean, because with Attenborough, it's so transparent he's a Darwinist. There is no debate at all. In fact, it gives the science programming a bad reputation.
Your applause for the panellists who have all done a great job representing the different aspects of this.